Okay, welcome back. This is lesson three. Today we're going to be talking about migrating and configuring user data. I hope you don't mind. I changed the background a little bit on this presentation just to make it a little easier, I think, to read. Today we're going to be looking at some of the things that we actually discussed in lesson three. We started talking a little bit about things like user state migration tools, and we were talking about easy transfer. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in depth today. And let's go ahead and get started. First and foremost, the objective 1.3 for the 70-687 lecture deals specifically with migrating user profiles. And while we're talking about migrating user profiles, we're going to touch base and talk a little bit about local roaming versus mandatory profiles. And of course, we're going to talk about default folder locations. So, configuring user profiles. What is a user profile? Well, a user profile, quite simply, is a container which is associated with a specific user account. That container will have all the personal documents, user-specific registry settings, internet favorites, anything that can be personalized to the specific user or group of users, everything that provides the user with a familiar working environment is stored in a profile. Now, prior to Windows 7, profiles were stored in the Documents and Settings folder on the C drive. But ever since Windows 7, we have changed that to the Users folder in the C drive. And once you go into the Users folder, you will see a whole slew of subfolders. Some are hidden, some are not, in each of the accounts. All the accounts are going to be named for the user identification for that particular user. So if you log in with the account Neil0029, you'll have a profile in that users folder called Neil0029 by default. With that said, there are occasional instances when maybe you update a profile or you change a profile, either you add it to the domain or whatever, where actually the profile name will not change, but don't worry about that. It's kind of not in the scope of today's lecture. But so for the most part, if you know the user's identification for logging into the system, their login name, you can find their profile in the users folder. Now, this is an example of what you can find in the users folder. This is one right off of my computer, for instance. Now, I don't have all the folders listed, but as you can see, there is a whole long list of stuff from application data, contacts, downloads, local settings, the desktop, all the icons on the desktop, as well as anything you store on the desktop can be found in the desktop folder, and of course, My Documents, which is where you'll find all of your Word documents. Sometimes you'll find game save files and things like that in there. If you're due lectures in Camtasia, like I am tonight, you would find a folder in My Documents called Camtasia, and you would find your lectures in there by default unless you change that location. Also, all your music and pictures and videos by default save to your user profile settings unless you direct them elsewhere. So, there are three main types of user profiles. We have the local user profile. The local user profile is what most users are familiar with when they get a laptop or desktop and they log in for the first time on that Windows 8 operating system. It will build a user profile for that user. That user profile is what we call a local profile. It sits and resides on the specific device that the user is using. Okay. Now, we have some additional profiles, one of which is called a roaming profile. A roaming profile is simply a copy of a local user profile that is then stored on a network share to which the user will have the appropriate permissions so that the user can access it from any computer on a network. This allows the user to have a consistent user experience no matter what computer that user is working off of. Now, and of course, obviously, unless the applications are installed on all the computers, there is going to be some variance as to what applications that user can operate off of. But as far as what is profile specific, that user experience will be consistent. You have to, in order to access a roaming profile, you're going to have to make some changes. You do this, if you're doing it on a computer-by-computer basis, you would do that through the user property sheet. But generally speaking, we do this as a matter of group policy, but I'll talk more about that momentarily. For a local user account, you would use the local users and groups snap-in. Available through the computer management console to access the user property sheet to make a change to point to a roaming profile. Now, if you are running a domain and you're running Active Directory Domain Services, which is the what we set up domains for, Active Directory, then you would actually go into the domain controller through the Active Directory Users and Computers console, and then you would access that particular user's property sheet and then point to the specific server and share folder where that roaming profile is located. The path to the roaming profile folder that you specify on the profile tab should use what we call the Universal Naming Convention, or UNC notation. That's the form that you see here where you have the server slash share slash the specific folder that the profile, the roaming profile will be located in. To use a single server folder to store profiles for multiple users, well, this is kind of what you would see in a typical network or corporate setting where you want everybody to have roaming profiles, and it shouldn't make any difference who logs into what system. We can do that using wildcards, and what you see here with the percentage username wildcards allows you to use roaming profiles regardless of the user that logs in, provided that he's logging into a profile with that specific username. For example, file server 1, profiles, users, and then the wildcard username. That means that for all of your users, every time each one will log into a system, they're going to receive a roaming profile in a separate subfolder named using his or her account in the users folder in the profile share on a server that we call File Server 1. This is one of those things that we're going to explore in more depth when we take NOS 230. When we're building our own file servers and building our own domain controllers, one of the things that you can do is actually set up roaming profiles for your users if you want to explore this a little further. So let's take a look at an example of a roaming profiles properties list. This is the profile tab for a domain users property sheet. You would find this in the users when you go to Active Directory Users and Computers. You find the user that you want to have roaming profiles set up for, and you would see when you click on the properties for that user in the domain controller, you can see that this has a significant number of more tabs than you would find in a local user's account. Things like member of is typical, but things like dial-in, remote desktop service profile, all these things are indicative to domain being able to, as a domain administrator, to administer some of the things. Anyways, in the profile tab, you would put a profile path pointing to the specific server and folder for that user profile. And if need be, you can actually incorporate a logon script that will run each time the user logs into the computer. Okay? Great. Now, another thing that we should talk about is mandatory user profiles. A mandatory user profile is basically a roaming profile that they can't change. It has read-only permissions on it. Now, to create a mandatory user profile, you do this simply by renaming the profile. A typical roaming profile has is called the ntuser.dat file. So in the folder, you would change the roaming profile to ntuser.man. Now, by changing that, if you're doing that in on a file server, then when you log in, it immediately knows that that is a read-only mandatory user profile. Renaming the file with the .man extension simply makes it read-only. That prevents the client from computers from saving changes to the profile when the user logs off. If you don't do that, then what normally happens is that whenever a user logs into a local station, if it's using roaming profiles, it will compare the roaming profile for the user on the station to the profile on the server. And it will pull down changes to the station to reflect the changes that are on the server. When the user logs off, those changes are then uploaded to the server so that when they log on to another computer, those changes can be pulled down in turn. But the read-only .man extension prevents that from happening. Now, managing profile compatibility. User profiles created with 8 or 8.1 are going to be not compatible with Windows 7 or earlier versions. So, if you're using a computer running Windows 8 or 8.1 to access a roaming profile and you are in a mixed environment being, say, a corporate network where you have both Windows 7 and Windows 8 machines, you're going to have some problems you're going to have to deal with. Now, what are those problems? Well, for starters, whenever a Windows 7 profile is encountered by a Windows 8 machine, the Windows 8 machine is going to automatically upgrade that profile to the new format. That's fine if you're all they're going to do is log into Windows 8 machines. But if you're still working in a mixed environment, that's going to make that profile unusable for Windows 7 machines from that point forward. So, what can you do? Well, to control which profile workstation uses based on the operating system version, you can go into the group policy settings and then set a roaming profile path for all users logging into the computer. How would you do this? Well, first we need to talk a minute about group policy. Group policy is a way that administrators are able to control variables in a network. For instance, I can set a group policy that will affect all Windows 7 machines so that all Windows 7 machines conform to a set of rules. And those rules are governed by group policy. I can do the same thing for users. I can create a group for users and then apply a certain policy to those users. And then no matter which one of those users logged in, as long as they're part of that group, they're going to be affected by the policy I have chosen. I can do the former when it comes to changing these profiles. So I can have on a domain, I can have a group policy specifically for Windows 7 systems, which points specifically to Windows 7 profiles, roaming profiles, in a different location on my server. Or I can have a group policy for Windows 8 machines pointing to yet another profile in another folder on that server. Therefore, it doesn't make a difference which system the user logs into. It will update those profiles for those specific systems based upon the type of system that they're logging into at that time. Here's an example of setting a roaming profile path for all users logging into a computer. So, in this particular instance, we are changing the group policy. In this instance, what you see is that the group policy is not configured, but we could go ahead and configure this group policy and then create a roaming profile path for those specific systems. If this is a little above your head, don't worry. We'll talk a little bit more about this in NOS 230 or in CTS 155 if you so take it. All right, let's move on a little bit. So, let's talk about migrating and configuring user profiles. Now, there are two basic methods for deploying Windows 8.1 operating systems to a client while retaining the profile settings through upgrade and migration. Microsoft has created two different tools for migrating files and settings to new computers. The Easy Transfer tool, Windows Easy Transfer tool, and the User State Migration tool, which we talked briefly about in the last lecture. I want to talk a little bit more about both of those tools now. The Windows Easy Transfer tool allows users to migrate the user profile data from one computer to another in a variety of scenarios. I can choose the number of computers, whether it's going to be a direct or indirect transfer, and I can also choose the storage medium that I want to store the profile on in the interim. So let's talk about a couple scenarios, and these are scenarios right out of Microsoft's examples. Say you're a user, or there's a user who purchases a new computer on which they want to run Windows 8.1, but that user wants to retain the files and settings from their existing Windows computer, an all too common practice. Or maybe a user wants to install Windows 8.1 on their existing Windows computer, but they've got a lot of stuff that they don't want to lose in the process of that. But because they want the performance of a clean install, then they may want to do a clean install on that system and migrate those files and settings back. These are both good instances where the Windows Easy Transfer can come in handy. Now, the procedure for migrating those files is as follows. First of all, you're going to save the user profile information from the existing computer, and then we're going to transfer that information from the storage medium back to whatever the new computer is at that time. So, there's some things that we need to talk about when it comes to Easy Transfer. For instance, the version of Windows Easy Transfer that's included with 8.1 is compatible with Windows 8 and 7 versions as sources only. It is not compatible with anything earlier than Windows 7. Even the ones available from the Microsoft Download Center that are designed to work with Windows 8 compatibility. So, no matter what data you choose to save when running the Windows Easy Transfer on a Windows 7 or 8 source system, the version included with 8.1 can only transfer files. It cannot import any Windows settings, and in addition, the Windows 8.1 version functions only as a transfer destination. It can't save data for transfer to other systems. The 8.1 version of Windows Easy Transfer also only supports migrations using a removable storage device, such as an external hard drive or USB flash drive. So, this is an example of actually using the Windows Easy Transfer. Very simple. As you can see, I'm going in, I'm selecting where I'm going to put my transfer file. I'm telling it it's my old computer. Once I do that, I am scanned. It's going to scan and pull all the profiles that are on that computer and find all the data that's related to each of those user profiles. This can take a few minutes. As you can see, we're still scanning and looking through, pulling all that data off of that's affiliated with each of the users on the system. So it scans, it's looking for all that data that's linked to a specific user. Okay. Still doing the same thing. And then we move on, and then it will also look for shared items. These are items that may be shared amongst all the users. Once that's done, then we have the ability to copy that information to some sort of a storage medium. Okay? Now, as you can see, we are now selecting which user profiles we want to transfer the data for to our new system. In this particular instance, I just want the student information. I can password protect this Easy Transfer file too, so that not anybody can copy and take this data from me and use it elsewhere. Once that's done, I select the location that I want that data to be stored. In this case, as an example, I'm just saving it back to the C drive. Obviously, you wouldn't do that if you were going to wipe the system, right? So, once that happens, then it will begin to save the data to the location you have chosen. Once again, that data could be an external hard drive, it could be a USB drive. Okay, that's been completed. Now, when that's done, then you are pretty much finished with the download procedure for the Windows Easy Transfer. Once I have my new system completed, whether I've wiped this one and added the data back, or whether I have a new system altogether, I would simply insert the USB drive, I would run the Windows Easy Transfer, and then I would tell it that this is the new computer. I would select my profile that I wanted to have copied, type in the password, and it would begin to download the data back to the new system. All in all, it's a pretty simple task. So, in addition to the easy transfer tool, first of all, we probably all talk about why don't we use that all the time. Well, for starters, that's a great tool when you want to do a straightforward copy from one system to another. You're looking at doing a small number of systems. But there is a more powerful tool that will allow, when combined with other tools, a lot of flexibility in the process, and it can be used on multiple systems at once. That is called the User State Migration Tool, or USMT. It has the same basic capabilities as the Windows Easy Transfer. However, USMT is going to be a command line program. It doesn't have that graphical interface, and it does include two separate command line programs, ScanState, which will save the user profile data, and LoadState, which restores previously saved user profile data. This allows the migration tool to be used on multiple systems if need be, in conjunction with System Center's Configuration Manager. So let's talk or summarize each of these migration tools. So, Windows Easy Transfer, it's free. It's a great choice for consumers, not a great choice if you're a network admin. For User State Migration Tools, it's free. It's a scriptable solution for network admins, which means that I can apply it to multiple systems. And it does have a limitation because the configuration must be set manually. Now, Windows ADK, or what we also call Microsoft Deployment Toolkit 2012, although it's free, it is partially automated user state backup and restore, and the disadvantage is that it does have a steep learning curve. MDT is a great tool. Windows Deployment Toolkit is a great tool, particularly if you are managing hundreds of systems, but maybe not capable of spending the money for a System Center Configuration Manager. Windows ADK or MDT are good substitutes. However, if you're working in a very large entity and you want a fully automated method of deploying operating systems to either bare metal machines or machines all over the network at once, System Center Configuration Manager 2012, SCCM, is the tool of choice. Now, it does have a high licensing cost and the system requirements are pretty stringent, but it is a commercial product that allows for full automation of user state backup and restore. Now, there's a lot of back-end work that is done prior to utilizing this tool on the production network. So, if you bring in System Center Configuration Manager, you're going to probably have a dedicated SCCM person on your staff that is capable of making those configurations and then allowing your user team to go out and deploy and use SCCM to do those pushouts of the operating system. So, summarize, Windows Easy Transfer. Great for a single user, a typical user with a retail machine looking to transfer stuff quickly. User State Migration Tools, a scriptable tool that can be used with conjunction of SCCM or as a standalone product for network administrators looking to do something more robust. Windows ADK and MDT. MDT is a server-based product that sits on a server, and you build images and you can push those images out and use MDT, part of MDT, to actually do the migrations. Very fantastic tool, though not fully automatic. So if you're looking for fully automated user state backup and restore, SCCM is the tool of choice. Now, with that said, let's talk about configuring folder redirection. Folder redirection is basically a feature in 8.1. It simply means that we're going to store a copy of certain user profile folders on another computer, usually a file server. To implement folder redirection, you must join the workstation to an Active Directory domain services domain. And I'm going to have to create some group policy settings with that domain controller that's going to specify which folders I want to redirect and where we're going to store them. Here's an example here of a new group policy object where we've gone in and chosen folder redirection, and then we can go in and select where we want to have that information, what server it's going to reside on, what folder in that server, and then from that point forward, the folder redirection will be enabled for whatever groups we associate with this policy. Here in the property sheet for folder redirect location properties, we're saying that we want a basic redirection that's going to redirect everyone's folder to the same location. If I chose advanced, then I would be able to specify locations based on various user groups. So, folder redirection group policy settings. So let's look at the settings. Basic, like I said, basic is a very simple, I want everything to go to the same place regardless of who the users are. Advanced lets me specify locations for various user groups, causes the workstations to redirect the folders to different locations based on the group memberships for those users. And of course, the follow the documents folder, that allows the pictures, music, and videos folders to be redirected as subfolders of a documents folder. The target folder location, that'll create a folder for each user under the root path, and it causes workstations to create a separate folder for each user on the user share, on the server share. It also will allow, we could also say redirect to the following location, which will cause workstations to redirect the folder to a single location for all users. And there's also the option of redirect to local user profile locations. This causes workstations to redirect the folder to the user's local user profile location. We'll continue. So with root path, RootPath specifies the server share where you want to store the redirected folders. There's also the grant the user exclusive rights to the folder, prevents anyone except the user from receiving permission to access the redirected folder. We do this a lot, particularly with any kind of redirection of profile stuff. We also can choose move the contents of the folder to a new location. This will cause the workstation to copy the contents of the redirected folders on its local drive to the target folder on the share, on the server share. We can also apply redirection policies to Windows 2000, 2000 Server XP, 2000 Server 2003 operating systems, and this is just a compatibility mechanism that allows us to perform folder redirection on earlier operating systems that may use different folder names in their profiles, such as My Documents instead of Documents and Settings. Policy removal, leave the folder in the new location when the policy is removed. That causes the workstation to direct the folders back to the local drives without copying their contents from the server, thus rendering the contents no longer accessible. Or I could redirect the folder back to the local user profile's location when the policy is removed. That causes the workstation to copy those contents of the redirected folders back to the local drive. And that's in the event that I, as an administrator, disable the folder redirection group policy settings for whatever reason. I can ensure that they still have what they need to do their job. It's just going to be back on the local machine again. So these are some of the settings that you choose whenever you set up folder redirection. So, fairly quick chapter. Let's summarize. A user profile, quite simply, is a series of subfolders located in a specific user account folder. In our later operating systems, that's going to be on the user's folder in the root drive, the C drive. That contains personal documents, it's going to have the user-specific registry settings, internet favorites, all that stuff will be stored in there as long as it's specific to a specific user's working environment. Now, a roaming profile is a user profile that I have moved to a network share of some sort so that that profile can be accessed from any computer on the network. Now, a subset of a roaming profile is a mandatory user profile. That's just a roaming profile that I've set as a read-only roaming profile. Particularly useful in high security settings where I don't want things to change. I want everybody to have a consistent feel on a system. So I can do that with a mandatory user profile. Now, as far as migration tools, the easy transfer tool, perfect tool for single users copying small amounts of data from one machine to another. Perfect, particularly when you want to do a clean install of an operating system on the same computer. You can simply copy your data over to an external drive and pull it back again. However, if you're looking for something more robust, even if it is not a GUI interface tool, it's certainly it's just a command line tool, the user state migration tool has the same capabilities. The only difference is that it's command line. It does not have the graphical interface, and the book doesn't say it, but it is something that is used in concert with SCCM. Folder redirection is just a way in Windows 8.1 that will allow me of storing a copy of certain profile folders on another computer, usually a file server. So that's it for Lesson 3. Next week, we'll be looking at Lesson 4. I believe that deals with storage, and I look forward to seeing you then.